We're going to test just for a second. We'll just turn the music down. We'll turn up. And we'll turn up number three. One, two, three. It's coming on. Okay, great. Thanks.
Don't
Good morning, everybody. Welcome to our meditation this morning. So in meditation, our desire is to become aware of awareness itself, where the object of awareness is not simply our mind, but awareness itself. So initially, we suspend the mind just a little bit. Huh? We suspend reflection. And we gaze into the gaze. In that metaphorical way, we become aware of awareness itself. Exactly how one does that is not easy to say, is it? It's sort of like raise your right forefinger. In time, we can all do that. But exactly how we do that is a bit mysterious. So we'll simply focus our awareness on itself. As we turn inward, as we enter into this awareness, the yogis use the word sunyata. It has various meanings that describe the experience of this awareness. So even as we're doing this together right now, it may feel like an emptiness or a nothingness or a void or openness, pure openness. Spaciousness, and we can experience the horizon. Sometimes the horizon is just our body, and sometimes the horizon is beyond our body, and sometimes it's just infinite and vast and unbounded. And even as we do that, just like we're doing right now, we're also at the same time integrating our mind into that awareness. Into that spacious knowingness. As we practice this in a cumulative way, sort of like an apple a day, the experience expands and the qualities of awareness begin to manifest in our body and infuse our body and infuse the mind. the spaciousness. And within the spaciousness, we begin to experience that it's alive, it's vital, it's energy. In the most profound way, it is life itself. It is the anima. And as we allow ourselves to stay with that experience in a cumulative way, it becomes very clear. Clear light. Knowingness, knowing, knowingness. And begins to manifest as light, radiant light. And wherever we experience the field, if it's only in our body, we'll feel oneness in the body. If it goes beyond our body in a situation, even if the situation is not particularly to our liking, we'll still feel the oneness. The very nature of awareness is oneness. The more we learn to hold this awareness and enter it slowly but surely, we become it. Rather than becoming our thoughts, rather than becoming every affect, we become awareness. And as we become awareness, our mind, for the first time, feels held and supported. Often, our minds think they have to hold everything and support everything, or regardless. But with the arising of the manifestation of the field of awareness itself, the mind can begin to rest and be infused by spaciousness, by the energy, and by the light, and by the sense of oneness, which is completeness. As you and I cumulatively practice, like an apple a day, awareness opens up even more. What the yogis call the kayas. So first we discover that our mind is not our awareness. And then we discover that this awareness is a field, vast and multi-dimension. So we begin to experience the dimensions of our own awareness. As the Nimayakaya dimension opens, we begin to feel the radiance between ourselves and the world. First within our own bodies, and then between us and each other. Both people and the animals. And then there's a third leap in the Nimayakaya, where the very physical world itself begins to manifest. Awareness. Then we begin to experience that this world is anima, is psyche itself. That we don't have psyche, we are in psyche. That the world is consciousness. Not because we believe it, because believing is not seeing, but because we experience it unmediatedly. Knowingness, knowing, knowingness. As the Nimayakaya appears, then the Sambhogakaya dimension may open. And the Sambhogakaya is the archetypical dimension, the cosmological energies manifesting, huh? The light, the vortexes. It's like streams, sheaths of light and energy. We begin to experience the underbelly of the Nimayakaya. We begin to experience what what the yogis call the deities, the devas and dakinis, which are simply personifications of the cosmological energy. So slowly but surely, we become less psychological person and more a cosmological being. Then, another dimension of our own awareness opens, which is called the Dharmakaya, or the Mahamudra, as Lama Wanderer was teaching us a few weeks ago. The great potential space, the vast space, the virtual dimension, unmanifest, there. Creativity, out of which everything arises, every process, every person, every experience, arising in us, manifesting as us. So slowly but surely, we begin to experience the multidimensionality of our own being, which is liberation. Less locked in by the captivation of a situation, the captivation of a moment. The captivation of good and the captivation of bad. The captivation of right and the captivation of wrong. The captivation of pleasure and captivation of pain. And so our very karma, our very life becomes luminous. Not without difficulties. Same exact story. Except it is luminous. Embodied consciousness, embodied awareness, incarnational, including everything, nothing left out. There's a great text. There were a number of texts on Yeshitogo. Yeshitogo is a Dakini, a goddess. And like most of the goddesses, she reflects the three dimensions, Nimayakaya, Sambhogakaya, Dharmakaya. On the Nimayakaya level, she was supposed to be a real person who lived and was a companion of Padmasambhava and the major person who brought that lineage forth. On Sambhogakaya level, they describe her body, the body of light, which is our body. So the text, first of all, describes a physical body, hair, teeth, parts, flesh, as the manifestation of the Dharmakaya in the flesh, incarnation. And then the text goes to the Sambhogakaya level, which is all of us also, and begins describing the body as deities, as the energies, the body of light. And they describe this in terms of the bodhisattva and the consort, describing that close union of oneness between knowingness and the object of knowingness. The same singular awareness arises in the body through the senses and knows through the senses. So the tongue is Avalokiteshvara, and the companion, that which is tasted, is Gita. And the eye is Krishnagarbha, and that which is seen is Lasa. And in the ear is Vajrapani. And what is heard is Mala. There's the nose. There's the bodhisattva. And that which is smelled. In this way, these texts are trying to bring forth the tradition of Buddhism, that the appearances and the experiences that you and I have and are is divinity itself. So as the yogi becomes aware of their own awareness, and that awareness begins to permeate their bodies, and the body of light becomes more feelable, more experienceable, then it permeates the senses of hearing and seeing and smelling and feeling. And the very bliss of the experience is the bliss of the Dharmakaya, ultimately. They use concrete language to describe this, huh? The oneness between the touch and the touched. The oneness between your thumb and forefinger. In the activated field is bliss. The more you and I bring forth this awareness, the more you feel the field itself, the more bliss, jouissance, will pervade our body. It does not simply depend on our mind. As Longchenpa says, you can be nuts, completely nuts, and that does not have to interfere with the luminosity. The practice of being in awareness with all the distractions, like that screechy sound, is to take it in. If we can pull it in, if we can pull the intensity of pleasure, if we can pull the intensity of pain, if we can pull the intensity of fear, if we can pull the intensity of taste, we take everything into the awareness field, and the field becomes stronger and stronger and stronger. If we pop out because of pleasure, we pop out of the field because of pain, then the process of natural liberation does not take place.
if we take our judgment and we believe that we can only be in awareness when things are good, we're in the right place, we're in the right time, we have the right sounds, that very judgment will foreclose our experience of the awareness which is manifesting that very sound we heard, and which is manifesting the very thoughts we feel, and which is manifesting the very judgments we're making. Focus back in now for a moment. The more space you and I are in, then the more we can integrate everything. The more space that we are, the more we can dissolve everything. The very power of the awareness is that it absorbs and dissolves everything. This capacity of metabolism, this capacity of dissolving, allows us not to be stuck. That's why awareness is the fire element. It is fire. It has an intensity to it as it absorbs and dissolves experience. There's one more text. I'd like to read from. This is another Yeshe Togo text, and this text is by Dzogchen Rinpoche. Again, it's on the subtle body. So the first text describes the subtle body in light of the configurations of the energies, the senses being fused and influenced or infused by the light of awareness, the amplification of the senses. This second text, again on Yeshe Togo, the Dakini, will describe the heart as the center of consciousness and the center of the luminosity. It goes like this. The foundational pure awareness, primordially uncreated, is the natural Dakini of great bliss. And within the vision, your vision and my vision of the uninterrupted direct perception, I embrace and I praise this great wonder. In my heart, in the center of the joined sun and the moon, and the sun is the bright light of it, and the moon is the soft, embracing light of it, is a syllable BAM, B-A-M, surrounded by the matrix syllables, and light illuminates forth and pervades my own situation, just as it is. So appearances, sounds, thoughts, and all the phenomena, both internal and external, are the play of the deity, the play of the mantra, the play of this primordial knowingness, this awareness. Om Yanadakini Bam Hari Nisa Siddhi Hung. So then the text is giving the Dakini mantra, and it's the text of empowerment. Om Yanadakini, O knowingness, O feminine knowingness, meaning direct perception. In these traditions, the feminine is direct perception, the masculine is skillful means. Om Yanadakini Bam Mahari Nisa Siddhi Hung. So we breathe in Om Yana Dakini Bam. Then you place Ma in the center of your heart. Then above that you extend it to Ha, to the left Ri, to the bottom of the heart Ni, and to the right Sa. Then you say Siddhi Hung. It means I invoke the power of this. So Om Yana Dakini Bam Maha Rinisa Siddhi Hung. Om Yana Dakini Bam Maha Rinisa Siddhi Hung. The text continues. From the circle of the mantric syllables in my heart, light rays radiate out, pleasing and invoking the primordial guru, which is the light of my own awareness. So my body, my speech, and my mind is empowered. And the blessings are condensed into light rays and nectarian states, which dissolve in my four places. So the energy dissolves where? Dissolves in my forehead, third eye. It dissolves in my throat. It dissolves in the heart center. And it dissolves in the navel. And through the bestowal of these four empowerments, the primordial wisdom of great bliss is experienced. Om Yana Dakini Bam Maharinisa Siddhi Hung. Clouds of light rays arise from the seed syllable in my heart. Move focus. And by intensely radiating forth, they fill the space around me and through me. And by taming through pacification, this means one learns how to pacify the energy, huh? To moderate it. One learns how to cool it out a little bit. Or through expansion of it, huh? Through the intensification, one learns how to expand it and extend it. One learns how to hold the power of the awareness in one's own heart for the benefit of one's own self and others. And also, fourthly, one learns how to use the fierceness of it, the fierce quality that cuts through stuff, so that all the activities are accomplished. Om Yana Dakini Bam Mahari Nisa Siddhi Hung. And then it says, there's four more little mantras. Diseases, negative forces, negativity, obscuration are pacified, dissolved. Shitam Kuru Soha. Then life, merit, glory, wealth are increased, Potring Kuru Home. And the three realms, one begins to feel at home in them, huh? The Nyamayakaya, Sambhogakaya, and Dharmakaya, Vasham Kuru Ho. And then the harm doers, enemies, and obstructed forces are subdued, Marayat. established ourselves in the awareness state, let's extend through our body. Activating the energies then we'll extend to each other If nothing happens in your meditation, the practice of extension will help bring forth the power of the field, the energy, the space. As you and I extend to each other, a co-emergent process happens. And oneness arises. Extension and the expansion cuts through solipsism. Which is a temptation for the yogi. And then we will extend to our ancestors, who you and I are expressions of. We extend in support, in gratitude. Mothers and the fathers are the mothers and the fathers. It also brings the power of awareness into the generational field. And then we'll extend to the great yogis, the teachers we've met in our life, both the known and the unknown. Again, in mutual support. With each extension, the field will expand, your perception expands, the base becomes bigger, more multidimensional. Then we'll extend to the traditions that we participate in, which are themselves fields of knowledge and information and light. Articulated over the centuries. And today, with geography being so tiny, information so easy, we can have many initiations, huh? And so these various traditions mix in our bodies, and we become universal people. And then we'll extend to that mysterious dimension, the Sambhogakaya, the archetypical, the gods and the goddesses, the devas and dakinis. So we'll extend this morning to Yeshe Togo as the form of the Divine Mother, embodied as her own body. as the oneness of the field arises in the Vajrayana understanding, everything can be dissolved. When it's just two minds, only in the mind with each other, not easy. You put seven minds together, and everybody's only in the mind, even more difficult. When two people are in the field together, then the power of the field holds both the minds and the dissolving process takes place. The de-densification of an attitude, the de-densification of affects, and the de-densification of positions. Potential space arises. Creativity arises. When you're with another person, or any sentient being, one way the Vajrayana yogis suggest is you extend the field into the person. We'll do that now. You just extend and you place it in the person, and then you pull like the underbelly of the field, you just pull it gently. And then you extend again to each other. In this way, the field opens the field. The light opens the light. As the field opens more, then the extension can be from the inner heart to the inner heart. So in these traditions, in the Dzogchen Mahamudra traditions, the deity, the god, the goddess, Dakini, is not an entity outside our own self, but it's the very power, the very shakti of our own awareness to transform ourself in the immediacy of the situations as it presents ourselves, as it presents itself. Being in the awareness state, becoming aware of awareness, is fundamentally a relational undertaking. It cannot be done simply by oneself. It doesn't mean the other people have to be conscious of it, but they're players in the unfolding of the light of awareness. That's why the metaphor of the bodhisattva and consort is so often used at many different levels. Relationally. Which happens to be where most of our difficulties lie. In this world. So let's extend to each other again. We open the field again. With each extension, as we bring it back, we go further into our body. Then the body will open up more and more. Father Dujan Rinpoche, in a great prayer called Invoking the Lama or Invoking the Guru as oneself, he says, really, prayer is great, but if it's too much whining, begging, pleading, it actually can weaken you. And it's much more powerful to take the light of awareness in your own hands and your own hearts and extend it to those people who are having difficulties. So we're going to do that as we end up today. We're going to extend to people we know and love. Extending the light to the light, inside to inside. At the level of awareness, there's no, it's non-local. There's no distance whatsoever. So Dujan Rinpoche used to say, we like to pass the buck to somebody else. Rather than taking the power of the light of our own awareness as our own self. We pass it to some guru, some holy being who we've never met. We'll also focus the light on our city right now. And we'll focus the energy and the light on our country, where there's so many problems right now that are emerging very, very rapidly. In this world of yoga, the only protection ultimately is having a very strong field, is being a strong field. So we're going to start to end up now. It's about 8:30. We like, we can rub our hands together. We place it in our heart, but we don't end the meditation. We don't end the awareness. So we don't turn it off and now we're back into our regular brain. Rather, in this tradition, you don't actually end meditation. You integrate the rest of your day into the state of awareness that you have come to. And we can put that chant back on number one. I think it's number one. So there's some refreshments upstairs. I'd like to thank everybody for coming today. And we're going to have the Yeshe Lama Retreat June 5th to the 11th. I'm really happy about Rinzhen Dorje coming, whose father was Khunseng Dechen Limpa, who was such a great, great, great yogi.
Time.